What does it mean when the Lord began to speak with me about the wedding of the Lamb of God? And I can trace back the conversations from 11th of November the year 2003, when he was pursuing me to talk to me about this mighty wedding of the Lamb, so I may come and serve him. And at that time, I did not understand the calling. And that was the voice that was saying, go tell the four ends of the earth to repent and prepare the way of the Lord. You see that? And I did not understand. And then it came down to, because it was difficult at that time to perceive the gravity, even the depth of what that means. And then the 2nd of April, the year 2004, when finally in that mighty visitation of the Lord finally presented John the Baptist on my right hand side. And John the Baptist began to speak with me about the wedding of the Lamb of God, about the coming of the glorious Lamb of God. What does that mean to the church? And then, all the things about that visitation we published, you can be able to read them, I don't want to go into that. And then the 17th, by the way, 17th of March, the year 2004, the first time in a mighty vision showed me how he is coming to take to rapture the church. The day the Lord walked for me across the sky, and every footprint he left was glorious, glorious across the sky. I could see everywhere he walked in that mighty visitation. And then he showed me how the rapture will take place, how he would rapture the asleep in the dust of the earth, and also how he would rapture the holy living Christians. You see that? After that, I am jumping into the 1st of November, the year 2006, when he presented the wedding rings in the sky. Now, talking about the wedding of the Lamb of God. Two wedding rings, one for Christ, the Messiah, and the other for the church. And then, come now the 26th of November 2006, at Kehancha, when we had this binational repentance at Sirare, Tanzania, and also Kehancha. Then he speaks with me how they are asleep in the dust of the earth. Those who are dead Christians, wholly dead, the righteous people who died when they were righteous, they had repented. How they will be raptured and caught up in the wedding of the Lamb. And then, after that, the 3rd of May, I'm just mentioning the main conversations that God has been speaking, that our brethren from Rwanda, Uganda, Tanzania, they are all, I know, they are, these two are updated. But the 3rd of May, the clock of God in the sky, when he finally lowered down the clock of the Lord, the clock that is 1 minute to midnight. You see that? 11:59 p.m. You see? And then finally, November 20th, the year 2007, when he showed me the house of the Lord, the dome, the golden dome in that vision, and then the scaffold metal and the roof of the church. But the dome was sitting on top of the church. And then the glory of the Lord came from heaven and settled on the dome, but did not enter the church. And then the voice of the Lord brought me very close, face to face with the door to the house of the Lord, which was closed. And the voice of the Lord said, let us enter into the house of the Lord. And the doors opened, the double arched door opened. And when I entered there, I saw a lot of, almost multi-millions of chairs. I could not see where they ended. They were black. And then grass began to grow in the church. And the voice of the Lord said, they used to worship here, but not anymore. After that, April 8th, when finally he interpreted that vision. But in between, March 26th, 2008, before April 8th, he now shows me the temple of the Lord in heaven, the temple of God Almighty in heaven. So, how does that relate to the door to rapture? Hallelujah. Listen to me, precious people. When the Lord engaged the church in all these conversations, there is one very important thing that remained common, you can call it a common denominator, in all these conversations. And that is, in every visitation, in every single vision the Lord was speaking to me about these issues, it began by heaven opened. You see that? The door to heaven opened into the sky. Before the rings were brought down into the sky, heaven opened. Before the cloak was lowered, heaven opened. Before the glory came and settled on the dome, heaven opened. Before the temple of God was unveiled, heaven opened. You see that? And so, the Lord has been using that to speak to the church. He has been telling the church, how come you can't see that I have opened the door? Hallelujah. I have opened the door. The door is open. And when the door is open, that means he's telling the church to get herself ready and enter. Hallelujah. You cannot wait. You will not be able to wait for the day of the rapture. Because on that day, he essentially closes the door. You understand? The door will be closed. That is the most important thing you need to understand. If you are waiting for the rapture, you will miss the rapture. Don't wait for rapture. Make sure you get yourself ready and enter. Look at the five wise virgins. They lift their lamps here, and when the door was open, they entered with the same lamps in. Hallelujah. And so God is talking about the need for the church to trim their lamps, okay, and get ready and enter through that door. But listen to this. I want to start somewhere. The book of Matthew, Matthew 24, and I want to go a little bit deeper, but as the Lord will help me, okay, so we can be able to be in the same page with the brethren from Rwanda, so they can go and teach this in their country, you see. Because we don't know the day, we don't know the hour, but we understand the message. The message says time is out, right? Yes, so Matthew 24, I want to read only a few verses. We can begin from verse 4 up to verse 9. And this is what he says. He says, watch out, Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, claiming I am the Christ. You see that? And will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. Verse 8, you want to pay special attention to that. He says, all these are the beginning of birth pain. Do you hear me, somebody? Remember from Indonesia, that was August, we were there August 5th all the way, and the Lord started speaking to me about the famine coming to the earth. You see that? And I started talking about global famine that is coming to the earth. That's going to affect Kenya very badly. Look at where we're sitting today. Global famine has entered the globe, the earth. Food shortage. Hallelujah. The earthquakes. You remember recently, is it 2 weeks ago, whenever it was? A week. Talking to the radio. Talking, the Lord spoke with me in the night. I called the radio. I said, now watch out. He's bringing more birth pain, the beginning of birth pain. We recorded it, aired it live. But in about 4 hours, it took place. You see that? And it hit almost the whole of Europe because it hit from Greece up to southern Italy. You see that? And then the floods I spoke on that very day. Look at now what's happening now in the US. And yesterday he spoke again of increase. He took me into their houses in the spirit. And I was in the houses and it was raining on us. So much rain was entering with wind. So people were being removed from their where they are. People were being removed. They were being removed from their houses, being thrown out. You see that? Get out, evacuated by force. You see that? Because of tremendous floods. And now I hear today that the Mississippi River has exploded out. It has crossed the banks and is now coming like a falls into the cities, you know? These are the beginning of birth pains, verse 8. And you can sense, you can look there and see the urgency with which God is operating right now. He's operating very urgently, which means his time frame is limited. You see that? But as he talks about the beginning of birth pain, the war coming to Iran, I was talking about that war. We published it in the Rapture magazine in 2006, in Tanzania actually, in Mbeya. Mbeya in October 2005. That's the first time the Lord spoke with me about the two missiles coming to hit the nuclear facility in Iran. Mbeya, the border town with Zambia. At the repentance meetings we had there. And so, now look at that. That war, the earth is sitting very close to that war. We published it in 2006. But now I hear the Israeli Air Force is training. You see? And that war coming to Iran will take place. He said, these are the beginning of birth pains. You see that? Because his disciples had asked him, Lord, when will the end come? How will we know that the end is coming? How will we know that your return is near? And he mentioned these things. And said, these are the beginning of birth pains. You know? Remember, the beginning of birth pains. And then, verse 9, he says, Matthew 24, verse 9, he says, after the beginning of birth pains, he says, then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death. Hallelujah. How do you jump from the beginning of birth pains, and then now he's talking about, then you'll be handed over to be persecuted and put to death. That means, between verse 8 of Matthew 24 and verse 9 of Matthew 24 is hidden the rapture. That is what is hidden there. Again, between Matthew 24 verse 8, the beginning of birth pains, and then finally he has just thrown them into the birth pain. Something has happened there. The birth pain is the tribulation. And that's why when you look back at Revelation chapter 16 verse 15, it says, behold, I come like a thief. Like a thief, secretive, you know. And blessed is he who stays awake and keeps his clothes with himself, that he may not go naked and be shamefully exposed. You see that? There is something secret about his coming on the rapture. And that is the door to the rapture. Hallelujah. And he says here that many will come and claim, I am the Christ. Deceive. You understand? And then he goes down there, he says, be careful, make sure you are not deceived. Which means deception will be one of the greatest spiritual landmarks of the time. There will be a lot of deception. And where? In the church. Hallelujah. Deception will enter the church. That is the message really that is there. That's what he's trying to emphasize. He's saying there will be a lot of lies in the church. Many will come and say, I'm the Christ. Many will come, and then he says, make sure you are not deceived. He was raising a red flag. One of the key landmarks would be the great deception that will enter the church. In other words, the Lord is talking about apostasy. The falling away from true faith. Hallelujah. And that means there will be a big wave of false prophets that would enter the church. And how will you know that they are false prophets? Kenya now is a bit more mature than other nations because the Lord has been speaking this for some time here. We've said very openly that there is no way someone is going to say he's a prophet of God, called of the Lord God. Hallelujah. And remember, it's only he that calls his prophets, right? And tell you, look, I came from the Samuel school of prophets. I was there for 5 years, now I'm a prophet. Isn't that blasphemy? They taught me to speak certain words, thus saith the Lord. You see the big deception that entered the church. It entered the priesthood first. Only the Lord God himself calls his prophets. Hallelujah. Amen. And he calls them to serve Christ. And now you know that there is no way someone will come and say he's a prophet, except that he comes and rebukes sin. There is no way he can be comfortable with sin if God speaks with him. You understand? At first I asked the Lord, why are you always showing me only bad things in the church? Until later I understood. That is what he was sending me to address. There is no way God is going to be comfortable with sin. Every time he sends forth a word, he has seen something that needs correction. There is no way God is going to send a servant who is going to build his own kingdom to lead people to himself. Every day in, day out, he's always going to point at the coming Messiah. The Lord says, make sure you're not deceived. Only this truth can ensure that they are not deceived. You see that? There is no way God is ever going to send a prophet that is not going to champion the holiness of the Lord in the church. That is common knowledge. Because the prophet is going to be the mirror image, the messenger of God. You see that? And God is holy. He's separated from sin. They have come as prophets. They have slept with women in hotel rooms in Kenya here. The women came to me for prayers. And the pastor took me to serve him in the hotel room. They come to preach. Then he's preaching about his shoes. Remember? Do you know how expensive my shoes are? Do you know where I bought this suit from? Look at my wife. Do you know how much it cost me per month to keep that hair? The truth will have to set the church free right now. You understand? Let me tell you, this is the moment of truth. Only the truth will keep you from what Jesus... My Bible is written in red. These are the words of Christ, the boss. Christ the King. The Honorable Lord. You see that? He says, make sure you're not deceived. But in between verse 8 and 9 of Matthew 24 is hidden the rapture. Because that means the birth pain you are seeing, the floods you are seeing, the earthquakes you are seeing, that means the famine, the global famine that you are seeing, these are the beginnings of birth pain. And look at the way he's increasing it. After I prophesy, it happens quickly, and then tomorrow night he comes, say again another one, say to them another one. There is a sense of urgency here, right? That's the first thing you pick from there. You begin to understand that God has shifted gears, moving faster. But I'm so surprised the nations are not aware. Listen to me, precious people. It's so important that you highlight this to the church. Let them not watch it as another news item. Oh, Mississippi River has exploded again. Oh, the earthquake in Greece again. Oh, now again, war in Kenya. Oh, now famine has come. Let me tell you, in a twinkling of an eye, in a flash, the rapture will take place. Because he jumped from there and said, and you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death. That is the tribulation. Isaiah chapter 26, I'm reading verses 19 to 21. He says, but your dead will live. Their bodies will rise. Hallelujah. You who dwell in the dust, wake up and shout for joy. In the dust because they are asleep. When Lazarus died, and they told him, Lord, but he has died. It's 4 days. That place is stinking now. It's smelling. He said, no, he is not dead. He is asleep. Hallelujah. So those who are under the dust of the earth, according to the Lord, they are not dead. They are asleep. Because all of them must be woken up. But your dead will live. Their bodies will rise. You who dwell in the dust, wake up and shout for joy. Why should they shout for joy? Look at the next subsection. Your dew, he says, your dew is like the dew of the morning. The earth will give birth to her dead. And he says, go, comma, my people, comma, enter your rooms. I don't know which version you're reading, but I'm reading from NIV. NIV says, go, comma, my people, comma, enter your rooms and shut the doors behind you. I'm talking about the door to rapture, okay? And he says, hide yourselves for a little while until his wrath has passed by. See, the Lord is coming out of his dwelling to punish the people of the earth for their sins. The earth will disclose the blood shed upon her, and she will conceal her slain no longer. You see that? I want to end there. How does this relate to the door to rapture? When the Lord showed this vision of the rapture to Isaiah, it is amazing here that the Lord showed him the elect, the remnant church that was going to be taken away through the door to rapture, and the door would close. You see that? Hallelujah. And then after that, the wrath of God would consume the four ends of the earth. That is the tribulation. And he says, you who are asleep in the dust of the earth, wake up. Levántate in Spanish. Wake up and shout for joy. Why? Because your dew has arrived. At first, when the Lord spoke with me about the door to rapture and he navigated me this scripture, I did not understand. Because I was looking at all the doors he has opened. When the rings were being lowered in the sky, he opened the door and the glory came out. When the cloak was being lowered, he opened the door and the glory came out, then the cloak. When the temple of God opened the door, glory came out, and then I saw the temple. Every time he opens the door to heaven, the glory comes out first. That's why Isaiah saw the same thing. He said, shout, wake up and shout, for your morning dew has come. That is the latter anointing of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. That is the Holy Spirit that comes in the latter anointing to purge the church, to purify the church, to cleanse sin from the church, because only the holy ones will enter. Only the radiant church, the glorious church, will enter, by the way. By the way. Only the church that is now righteous. By the way, he also says she must be mature, having grown to full stature, telos in Greek. Having grown to full maturity. That means she has grown in the faith. She has grown in, by the way, it is the holiness of the Lord that matures the church. Yeah. Don't think you'll mature by the number of years you spend in church. Don't think you'll mature in the amount of the number of churches, or the number of people you have led to the Lord. Hallelujah. I have led today, I have led 20 people, tomorrow I led 30 people, so I'm really maturing. You are not maturing if you're not very careful. It is the holiness of God, because the full stature he talks about is the reason the two wedding rings were very identical in that vision. Very similar. How can Jesus wear the same wedding ring like the church? That means the church has to measure up to the stature of Christ, the identity of Christ, to the maturity of Christ, to the holiness of Christ. That's why the Bible says, just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. The Bible also says, until you attain the holiness and the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. So when you see the glory of the Lord coming down in Kenya, hallelujah, the rain began from Kakamega, and it started raining, and a lot of rain of the Holy Spirit started coming down, and the Lord spoke the release of the four glorious horses from here, which I have now revealed. Finally, he allowed me to reveal the meaning of that, which I put into this paper very, very elaborately. You see? Talking about the four glorious gospels that are in the Bible. Telling the pastors that as you preach the Bible, anchor yourself on the four glorious gospels as you preach the entire Bible. Anchor yourself. You understand? Which means root your foundation on the four glorious gospels. You see that? And the word that cometh forth from your mouth will reach the four ends of the earth. You see that? And will clean up the church. Don't teach from other books. The church has been teaching on other books. The anointing for financial wealth. How to manage financial resources as a Christian. How to live healthy as a Christian. The church has been teaching the gospel of the flesh, the world, earthly gospel, outer court. You know, there was the outer court and the inner court. In the outer court, there's a lot of rumors. They don't hear directly from God. And yet the curtain ruptured, and the Lord allowed us unwarranted, unlimited access into the Holy of Holies. Hallelujah. Amen. And so Jehovah is saying that this door that he showed Isaiah, Isaiah saw when the elect were rushing into this door and the shutting of the door for the wrath of God to pass. This is the door to the rapture. If you will catch this, you'll see the wedding of the Lamb of God. There is no way you can be preaching repentance, preaching you are in the ministry of repentance, and then you miss the rapture. The rapture will not come as a church. We are going as a church. Paul says, let us be careful lest we preach this thing and we ourselves miss out on this thing. And it will be a shame. So it's very important to understand that this dew that comes is the latter anointing. That, you know, in fact, let me tell you, at first, as the Lord was ministering to me on this, I thought the morning dew was different from the midnight dew. You see that? Because when the clock he showed me is 11:59 p.m., I thought this latter anointing is going to be different from the morning dew, because Isaiah is saying the morning dew that takes them like this. It is one and the same thing. Hallelujah. Because when it strikes midnight, the morning has come and the church has been taken. You see that? So that is the glory, the Holy Spirit you see flowing in the church today. I mean, I'm talking about in Kenya. We have to bring it to other countries also. The latter glory heals the church, delivers the church. There is no more rumors and lies about healing and deliverance. Do you hear me? He says, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. Hallelujah. And he will anoint you. But that is the morning dew. Don't use it for showbiz, Hollywood. He will take it away from you. Don't use it, oh, look at how we are anointed these days. Use it to prepare the church to purify the wedding gown. So the church may be found without spot, without stain, without blemish, without any single tainting on the gown, without anything detestable, without any defilement. Let the gown be pure, holy, radiant, righteous. Let it be worthy of the calling as the royal bride. Royal bride. Into the king's house. You've been called as a bride into the king's house. It's not just a regular, you know, wedding. And it's a spiritual wedding. That's why he's saying, no, you cannot be preaching the latter anointing when people are still demon-possessed here. That would be a lie. They would have to be delivered. You see that? They would have to be healed. There is a lot of healing happening in the country right now. And you haven't seen yet nothing. There is more to come. I wish you could see what I have seen. But he's looking for people that will understand this scripture here. And know that the morning dew comes for the express purpose of preparing the church to enter through this door. And when you enter through this door, it closes. You see that? Let me share a little bit here. Finally, when John the Baptist stood here, and then the mountain glory of the Lord was in front here, and John the Baptist was beginning to talk to me about the coming of the Lamb of God that was going to come for the church, the first thing I realized is that his raiment became glorious. So glorious that you cannot even wash in any laundry on earth. No soap on earth can purify that white. Beaming like lightning. Hallelujah. And when I looked at myself, my raiment had become glorious too. My countenance, my features had changed. And I was shocked. Hallelujah. It's time for the church to mature now. You see? But after that, it was amazing. It was tremendously amazing to me that the glory that came before the Lamb was released from the mighty glory where the Father was, before finally the Lamb came, the glory that came out turned my clothes to be radiant and His. I was so amazed. There was no single spot you could hide. Not knowing that that is what Isaiah saw. Isaiah said, he said, hallelujah, let me jump ahead of myself. Verse 22. And he says down there, the earth will disclose the blood shed on her, and she will no longer hide her slain. Which means you will never hide any sin again. Hallelujah. When that glory comes, no sin can be hidden again. Don't use it for running around. It is for revealing the sin in the church, purge it off, cleanse the church, prepare the church. Hallelujah. It is not for, oh, the glory has come. We like doctor's meetings. When we go, the Holy Spirit comes and slays thousands of people. Cripples walk, what, people are healed, what? We love. Don't do that. That is the gospel of the flesh you see the evangelists are doing all over the world. That glory is for connecting the church to the kingdom of God. All these works he will do. But for the one and single purpose of preparing the church for the kingdom of God. And how do you prepare? When that comes, it unearths sin. You understand? Isaiah said, no more will the earth hide the blood shed upon her. Which means the evil that you ever did to the remnant church, the evil that was ever done to those who have chosen holiness will be exposed. Hallelujah. And he also says, Even her slain will not be hidden. They will be disclosed. She cannot hide anymore, any longer. That also talks about God will hold the earth to judgment on the day of rapture. Because the day of rapture, he divides the earth into two populations, the raptured and the remained. And if you remain, he says, it will be so difficult. You cannot even preach Christ because the Antichrist, I have seen a lot. I have seen the earth after the rapture. And the Lord says, when you try to preach Christ, you'll be beheaded. And if you refuse to wear his mark, God says he himself will send a spirit to confuse you to believe him. That means you want to enter the rapture. You want to make sure you're in the rapture. Don't fool around the rapture. That's why I wondered, why are the evangelists on earth not preaching the rapture? It was shocking to me. Why are they not preaching? Why are they not preparing the church? This is the most important message they should use to prepare the church. The earth will never ever hide her sin as that glory comes. And that's what Isaiah saw. But let me tell you something interesting. Because down there in verse 20 he says, go, comma, my people, comma. You see that? You see that? He's highlighting my people. My people. Do you see that? That his people, for them, they should now go inside through this door and then close the door behind themselves. The rapture door that I'm talking about today. So make sure, hallelujah, make sure that the rapture door closes you on the inside heaven part side. You are closed on the inside of heaven, that side of inside heaven. Do you understand me?
Yes.
Listen to this. There are two scriptures I want to handle here. I want to go to Zechariah 13 very briefly, so you may understand what he means by my people. Zechariah 13, you see that? The my people he talks about. You see, verses 7 to verse 9, Zechariah 13. Why does he highlight, go, comma, my people, comma, and enter your rooms and shut the door behind you? Why does he emphasize my people? He puts a comma before and a comma after to bring it out. Listen to this. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man who is close to me, declares the Lord Almighty. He says, strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. And I'll turn my hand against the little ones. Verse 8, now he's beginning to define what he means by my people. When God says my people, he says, in the whole land, declares the Lord, 2/3 will be struck down and perish, yet 1/3 will be left in it. Do you hear me? 2/3 will be struck down and perish, 1/3 will be left. You see, already he has pulled out 1/3. He's talking about a remnant. Hallelujah. Look at what he does with 1/3. He says, this third I'll bring into the fire and refine them like silver and test them like gold. They will call on my name and I'll answer them. I will say, they are my people. You see my people there? And they will say, the Lord, he is our God. So that means when God said my people, defining the true identity of the rapture church, he meant the remnant that will step out, hallelujah, they will say, just a moment, there has to be an end to this joke in the church. Do you understand? There has to be an end to this comedy in the church. There has to be an end to this sexual sin and the love of money in this church. If it is true that God says time is out, I remember the commission. You see that? The commission was that go into the dark world and win souls for Christ. You see that? And not just sitting and eating what? Milk. Do you understand? All the time milk. And the church is perpetually, continuously, constantly on a daily basis an infant church. He is not coming for an infant church. Mature church. He says, that church that has risen to the full stature of maturity. In fact, he uses the word mature. You see that? In Greek, telos means grown to full height until you've reached it now, you know? So he's telling the church, step out and evangelize. Get out of the four corners of the walls. Get out. As long as you are there, they will be lying to you. Deception will be there. But when you step out, you go to the marketplace. Marketplace. Stand at the door. Begin to preach the coming of the kingdom of God. Begin to preach the return to holiness and righteousness. Begin to preach the cross, the blood and the cross at Calvary. Begin to preach the salvation of our Lord Jesus. You will mature. Hallelujah. Because you will be attacked. You see that? You will be attacked right away. Right away. The city council will arrest you. Show me your permit for preaching here. You are making noise to people here. This person whose stall is next to you says you are becoming a nuisance to her. You are chasing away customers of other religions. People will say everything. I know it. I've been preaching the streets. I know what it means. Some look at you and say, whatever happened to this one? All things will be said at you. But the Holy Spirit will sustain you. And he will use that to purify you and refine you like silver. And then test you like gold. You see that? Sin will leave you. You will never ever deliberately choose sin against the Lord. Even the love of money, you will never choose it against Christ. That is what he meant when he said, my people. It is a church that is evangelizing. They are not sitting and saying, she touched my husband. The devil touched my husband again. He touched my finances again. That is not the church he calls my people. Because the Bible must be fulfilled. James chapter 4 verse 7, you see the mature church. Resist the devil and he will flee. Daktari, listen, Dr. War, you are telling us to walk in holiness, but all of us pastors have fallen. It's not just me. What do we do now? The Bible said in the last days there will be evil. That is not my people. You cannot fall because everybody has fallen. Because actually, if you look very carefully, this my people here is a separated church. Amen. Spiritually separated. Amen. That church knows how to stage a fight when she's attacked. And those attacks, she knows are good for her, that she may grow, right? And not to cry. So how can you as a pastor start crying that the enemy has attacked your finances, attacked your marriage, attacked your work, attacked your health, attacked your fellowship with other pastors, everything is falling apart in your life, attacked your church, attacked your sheep, attacked everything? How can then such a pastor bring deliverance to the sheep if you are not yet delivered? Is our God a liar? You have to be delivered first to bring deliverance to others. The word does not lie. That is what he calls my people. I'm talking about the door to the rapture. These are the ones that enter through that door. Oh, you know, these days we're in ministry of repentance. We are preaching, a lot of people are coming to the Lord, but are you entering? Are you yourself entering? That is the question. Are you going to enter? Because you have to live to everything you preach. John 14 verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. You see that? If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back. Did you hear that? I'll be back, he says. I'll come back and take you to be with, to take you, hallelujah, and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. In other versions, they say, there are many mansions. Do you hear me? In my Father's house, there are many mansions. But I like this version here, NIV, that he says, there are many rooms. Because Isaiah saw the morning dew had come, and the morning dew gave them joy unspeakable. The morning dew released them from the bondage of sin. No more sin will touch the rapture church. Amen. The morning dew made the church in the image and likeness of God. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 1 verse 21 to 26 down there. They now wear the glorious body. They have defeated death. They wear the immortal body, the imperishable body, the incorruptible body. They are now wearing the eternal body. They will never be touched by death anymore. No more sin will touch them. No wages of sin will claim them. Isaiah saw. Be joyful. Joy unspeakable. Never again will you die. Because the morning dew has arrived. But enter the rooms now. He saw them entering. And he said, please shut the door behind you for a little while. For a little while. Until his wrath has passed. 7 years. You see that? During the tribulation. A little while. You see that? Until the wrath has passed. You see that? Because after 7 years, Jesus will come back with the raptured church. I'm jumping ahead of myself. Will come back with the raptured church during the second coming of Christ in Jerusalem. You see that? That's why you have to enter the rapture. You must enter. It is a serious call to the people who are carrying the message of repentance, that you may identify this. Listen to this. He says, I go to prepare rooms for you. And in those rooms, I'll prepare for each one, mansions in other versions, and then I'll come back to take you so you too may be where I am. That is the rapture. You'll come back in the rapture and take the church. Do you understand? There is so much to teach in the word. You wonder, why would the church be teaching corruption of sow a seed here, get your miracle here? Why? Why would the church be wasting time in teaching healthy living, how to exercise every morning, good for your heart, good for what? The Bible says those things are things, those are infancy. They should not even be heard of. You're supposed to have grown from there. He can keep your health. Let me tell you, when you plug in to the Lord, you keep your health. Yes. By the way, you keep your health. I mean, the thing is, you've seen the tremendous healing going on in this ministry right now. Then, you know, you cannot claim that God does not heal. God has done his part. He does his part all the time. He's faithful. So don't start running to some psychologists. In the modern churches of Nairobi, Pastors are stepping out of pastoring to go first to Bible college to be trained counseling and psychological, how to counsel people. Stepping out of the word into the wisdom of the world, psychologist. So they may now I feel the Lord is calling me to a counseling ministry. So I need to go study a degree in psychology. Stepping out of the word of God into the wisdom of the world, so you may bring it and it will become a yeast in this world. Isn't there a problem in the church? And yet the word is so clear. I saw them enter and they were being told, shut the door behind you for a little while. You see that? Inside there is hidden the door to the rapture. And that's why he was able to say, like it was during the time of Noah, so will it be at the coming of the Son of Man. But before we go there, let's go just to Daniel chapter 12, precious people. The door to the rapture. Daniel chapter 12. Hallelujah. Verse 1. Hallelujah. He says, at that time, Michael, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. You see that? There will be a time of distress such as has not happened from the beginning of nations until then. Because you know, Daniel was writing from the east. Daniel is a prophet of the Lord that was called in the east. So he wrote his manuscripts and they were in the east. But he was an end time prophet. So he was seeing what was happening in the end time. And he had seen that there would be distress. That's why he said, such as has not happened from the beginning of nations until then, when that moment will come. Look at the flood we see today. Historic, never ever seen before. Look at the Myanmar. The cyclone. And then the Chinese quake, and then the floods. Look at what's happened in the United States today. Look at the blood flow Kenya went through. Look at the global famine that is going to sting the earth now. It's already stinging. In Egypt, they're falling in the lines as waiting for bread. As has never been seen, never since the beginning of nations until then. That's the beginning of birth pains. And then he says, but at that time, your people, do you hear that? We say, my people. Your people. Did you see that? Your people, they're my people. God's word is the same. The Holy Spirit is the same. He cannot show me a vision that's not lining with the Bible. He showed it to me in November 26, 2006. He showed it to Daniel the prophet. He showed it to Isaiah the prophet. He showed the same Holy Spirit. It is very consistent. It must tally. Otherwise, God has not spoken. You cannot teach other things. Only this you can teach. Because the purpose for which you were called as pastors is that you may lead the church into the kingdom of God, period. Anything else is an addition, isn't it? That they may enter. Otherwise, then why have you? You're not called to lead them to hell. But listen to this. He says, but you are people. I like that. But at that time, you are people. That's the my people you saw in Isaiah chapter 26. It is the same my people he defines in Zechariah 13. And he says, but at that time, you are people, everyone whose name is found written in the book. Hallelujah. The book of life. Those are the ones he has purified. And he says, everyone whose name is found written in the book will be delivered. Hallelujah. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake. Wake up. Some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many into righteousness will shine like the stars forever and ever. This is rapture. If it's so clear in the Bible, why hasn't the church taught it? Why would even someone contest such a message? A timely message, somebody. Right? So the Lord is speaking here very clearly. He's talking about the mighty dot rapture. You see very clearly that a lot of distress hits the earth. And suddenly, everything has happened. You know, I kept wondering, by the way, why every time I get to the altar, I have seen myself already in the dream at night that I'm preaching. And when I get there, I begin to preach the way I saw myself in the dream. I began to understand. Every time, the first thing I see is I am getting the altar and saying, on the 1st of November, the year 2006, the Lord, He opened heaven, and I saw two wedding rings, Lord. The first thing, whether it's in Canada, whether it's in Germany, whether it's in Rwanda, Uganda, Tanzania, where, it does not matter. The first thing He says, I began to understand. That means, like it was during the time of Noah, so will it be at the coming of the Son of Man. At the time of Noah, He sent Noah. He says, tell them the door is open. Tell them to enter now. Don't delay out there. Because on that day, I just come to close. Hallelujah. He sent me, in other words, to tell them, look, the door is open in the sky. You can enter now. The wise virgins, they lit their lamps, they entered and entered. Hallelujah. They lit the lamps here and entered with it there into eternity. The wedding gown you prepare today is the same wedding gown you enter with into it. I know the way He's speaking with me right now, there's a sense of urgency, speed. He wants things to be done fast. Every time He's showing me, today again in the night, again this night, in the sky again, He drew again the map of America, North America, and He showed me this side. And then He said, look, the plane is taking up there. Tell them, go tell them. He is in so much hurry. If He wanted, He would have just, you know, shut down all these things and just, that's it, you know. You go to other countries. Time has run out. Again today, twice in the night, by the way, He drew the map. I could see it in the sky. Then He said, look, 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 over there now. That's where the message should go. Because Kenya is eating all the time. It is time for other nations to eat, right? It is time for other nations to eat. It's time for other nations to eat. But listen to this. In Revelation chapter 19, this is a popular scripture. I've read it again and again. Verse 7, it says, let us rejoice and be glad and give Him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come. That is the glory that Isaiah saw bringing joy. You see that? And he says, and his bride has made herself ready. Verse 8, fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear. And my version says, fine linen stands for the righteous acts of the saints. Now, if you look at that fine linen, and then verse 9, it says, then the angel said to me, write, blessed are those who are invited into the wedding supper of the Lamb of God. And he added, these are the true words of God. That is the wedding of the Lamb of God. But when you just turn on the same page, I don't know how you were this on the same page, same chapter, just move forward from verse 11 on, talk about the second coming of the Lord. He says, I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse. You remember the white horse he showed me the wedding rings? Again, I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and makes war. Again, this says, his eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. There is even a worship song that says, he is crowned with many crowns. You see that?
Yes.
You see that? The darling of heaven crucified. You see that? It says, he has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood. The symbol of... Hallelujah. Let me share a little bit deeper here today. The first time the Lord Jesus appeared to me, in the sky, on that May 17th, 2004, when he appeared. Remember, during the calling, he appeared, but in the tremendous glory, and then he touched me with the left hand. We've shared about those things. They're not new anymore here. I've shared that the church may grow and know that the Lord has done a new move, you see? But I'm talking about this visitation, talking about the rapture, when he showed me how he's going to take the church, when his hands were significantly bigger and he pulled them, you know? By the way, it's the glory that pulls them from the tombs, that transforms you and takes you. That's why that morning dew is very critical. I want to talk about that morning dew a little bit. Someone remind me not to forget. That morning dew is the river that flows from the throne of God, from the temple of God in heaven, and it flows the four ends of the earth, empowering the four glorious horses that I saw which stood for the four white with the glorious gospels, that were to purge up, to clean up the four ends of the earth. You see that? The four glorious gospels are the ones going to clean up the church. Do you hear me? Once you anchor yourself on the four glorious gospels, then you can teach the whole Bible. You see that? You see that, somebody? And the glorious gospels are glorious, so they will bring radiance with the morning dew flowing from the throne of God, the life-giving Spirit of God, that can give life to their sleep, the dead, that they too may resurrect. You see that? We'll talk about that river, a river of life, and why Isaiah saw the morning dew, and also Daniel saw, I've seen it. So the thing is this. But here, what I want to emphasize to you on the rapture, the door to rapture, is that on that 17th of May, when he first appeared to me from the sky, he has a red cloth that runs from his left shoulder. You want to be mature, of course. Eh? Let's all be mature. He has a red cloth that runs from his left shoulder like this, down here. Red, 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 red. And you can imagine when it's red within the glory of the Lord. Let the church mature. I need to share. It's time to share these things now. The deep things about the person of Christ. You've lived on rumors for a long time, right? It's time to live on the truth. It is time for the church to live on the true word and the revelation of God. This is the same red cloth. Even when the hand came to touch me, the glory is tremendous. But you could see where it was punched. You see? The nail. So that's the first one. That's the first thing he does. When he was sure that I've focused on him in that vision, then he lifted the hand like this. Then look what I did for you. You see that? He is so satisfied that he did it. But the problem is this. He was so much abused. He was carrying a cross that would deliver you, the church. They beat him like a dog until he fell down, until the shoulder broke, until he could not even carry the shoulder that was carrying the cross. He fell down with it now. The shoulder broke. He collapsed. He was so shocked. In fact, until if you read Psalm 22, you see that he died more of shock than physical injury. He was so shocked at the amount of hate that these people had accumulated against him. How could you beat me like this? Until he wept. Beat until he fell down. You try to beat a dog right here in front of this gate like that, you'll be arrested. You understand me? Because there are laws protecting dogs, but there was no law to protect the Messiah. They beat him so horrendously, until now we have never been able to perceive the depth of the suffering of the Christ. That is the blood that is symbolic of the red cloth. The blood he poured for you. Hallelujah. How could you go to sexual sin if you really perceive the suffering of the Christ? How could you choose me, 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 self, me, me, me? I want to be happy. You know me, I want to be me, me, your feelings. Jesus never chose his feelings on that day. But he felt towards you. Hallelujah. It is time to mature up. And he does this. Say, look what I did for you. That's the first thing he shows you. So you may see. But when he looks at the wound, and the scars, then he asks, but where is the church that I purchased? Where is the church that I purchased? They are busy doing comedy, the pastors. Preaching, and the more funny you are, the better, the more anointed probably they think, right? People like him. Women laugh, they love that church, they go there. Isn't it? The more comical you are, the more you have more people, the more money you gather. Right? How can we say this is the temple of the Lord? The temple of the Lord. The temple of the Lord, and yet God is not here. He's asking, where is that church that I so much suffered for, the wounds I see, the scars I can see, but where is that church? They have joined politics. In Rwanda, people ran to churches, pastors turned around, killed them also. In Kenya, people ran to churches, pastors turned around and killed them. And they burnt them in the churches. Pastors surrendered them. Say, that was another tribe. Kill that one. He licked them. Pastors knew the list of who is from another tribe here in Kenya. Recently. Isn't it true? Where is the church that Jesus purchased? Hallelujah. And he says here, verse 13, Revelation 19. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood. You see that? And his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven, this is what I wanted to bring you on the rapture door. The armies of heaven are following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Did you see that fine linen before the rapture? And now you see it at the second coming of Christ. That means when you prepare today and spiritually begin to enter into the rapture today. Today you tell yourself, Lord, I am not going to wait for rapture, because that day you will essentially close the door. And it happens like this. So you don't even have time to prepare. I am going to prepare today, which means if I am a woman here, I'm going to my closet, look at what clothes are full of prostitution that I've been wearing. You see that? Some of you women have even kept clothes that some of your boyfriends gave you before you married. Some of you women have kept rings that some of your boyfriends gave you before you married your husband. That every day when you look at that ring, you feel good. Can we talk about these things?
Yes.
Let us talk today. Some of you women have kept even shoes that your other illicit, evil boyfriends gave you when you went to those dates. And you are busy lying to your husband that, you know, I'm just keeping it there. But every day you open the closet, you look at it, it has a quenching thing it does into your evil heart. Some evil quenching. That when this man disturbs me these days like this, I always go to the closet and smell the other cloth. Don't I know these things? They even smell that when I smell, I smell the other man. Do you want us to talk about these things today? It must end today. If you want to enter the rapture. You have watches and rings bought to you by some illegal, some evil relationships. You have kept them. I would tell you to throw them away. Right? The Lord is saying, get rid of the yeast. Because the devil will sneak in yeast without you knowing. You understand? If you want to enter through this door, do you hear me? When the devil sees Paul, he has the name Saul, and the devil has seen how God is planning to use him, the devil takes him earlier. You see that? So Saul is persecuting Christians. And then later on, writing almost 2/3 of the New Testament, right? So that's why you have to be very careful. Scrutinize them. Let the Spirit reveal to you. You see that? Time has come for you, the church, to enter. Let nothing stop you from entering through this door. Because you'll never enter with a car, with a home, with whatever your values are. You know, people have value systems. Homes, car, nini, whatever. School fees, school children, my kid to be educated. Whatever they are. Education of your kids. Let those things not stop you from entering through this door. Because here what I see is that the gown you prepare before the rapture is the gown you enter with where? Into the rapture. And it's the gown they are coming with back with Jesus. You see that? Did you realize that? The armies of heaven, those are the raptured saints. Verse 14, the armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses, dressed in fine linen, bright and clean. So that means what you decide today, we are talking today. You people have to repent today. If there is any speck, if you have that little watch that your girlfriend gave you many years ago, that spiritual little watch, I'm talking about spiritual now, that has been hidden in your heart. That woman, when you preach, she smiles at you. A little lusting going on, but you know I have my safety valves. You see that? No, I am safe. No. Your wife is complaining. Be careful. No. No, I'm mature. You have to throw that today here in repentance. Get rid of those little watches and throw them away. Do you hear me? The devil may have slipped them sick with, most of you know them anyway, or maybe secretly, without knowing. Whether it's a dress that is lingering in your closet, you've grown bigger than that dress. Throw it away. A man, if it is just that chain, that watch, I don't know, me I don't know, I'm just mentioning things. If it is a car, get rid of it. That every time I enter this car, I remember my girlfriend. The devil is using that to hold church hostage. In America, they entertained homosexuality at the altar. Now they cannot come out to rebuke homosexual marriages in California. Let us clean out the house. Because the same gown you prepare today, until eternity, you return with it where? To Jerusalem. And that's why Isaiah said, when he saw the door, He said, excuse me, when he saw the door, he said, enter those rooms, shut yourself, my people, into those rooms for a little while. That is 7 years. In the Jewish wedding, our Lord is Jewish, by the way. You like it or not? He's Jewish. In the Jewish wedding, I remember in Israel, my Jewish friends, when they were wedding, Ron, one of them is called Ron, the one who really invited me to his wedding, who wanted really me to be there. You see? When a young man discovers his bride-to-be, you see that? He takes her to her parents. There they drink one from one glass of wine. One glass they share in front of the parents. Hallelujah. And then the parents write a small scroll as a covenant that these two have agreed they will wait for each other. You understand? Now she will wait for me, I will wait for her. It's a covenant of faithfulness, right? The man takes this written scroll to the father and says, Father, I have discovered, I have found my bride. And look, we drank even from one glass in front of our parents. A sign of covenant. Hallelujah. And that is the covenant of the cup Jesus presented at Last Supper. Do you remember that? When he told the church, do this in remembrance of me. Meaning, please wait for me. Don't go to another man. Are we maturing today? And that is a covenant of spiritual faithfulness that the church ought to have maintained with Christ. To have waited on Christ. You don't go back and find that the girl you wanted to marry started going to drink in the bars. She has your engagement ring, but she's just out moving with men in sexual sin. The church is guilty of sexual sin, spiritual sexual sin. The church is guilty of unfaithfulness to the bridegroom. She went to the man of witchcraft, the man of the false prophets, the man of deception and lies, the man of money, the man of the gospel of wealth transfer being preached on Global TV today. That please, Christians, wait for a lot of wealth is going to come from the world to you. And yet that wealth will drift you away from Christ. That is common knowledge today, that wealth drifts people away from the Lord. Makes men drunk. After, you know, pastors begin, I want to preach, I'm hungry, I'm fire. The Lord sends a few people in his life, anoints him, he preaches with fire, more people come, his basket of offerings grows. Tomorrow a big car, tomorrow America, where Europe, Australia. After that, he now wants political power. He wants to go to parliament. He's now quitting the very boss who raised him. He's going to another boss. Because there is now more money and political power. Haven't we seen it in Kenya?
Yes.
Didn't the Lord send me to rebuke it?
Yes.
So, when the Jewish young man goes to his father with the scroll, the father says, wow, he reads, you've got your bride. That's very good. Only the father from that day on, only the father knows the day of the wedding. The mother does not know. The young man will never know. But in the Jewish culture, that is the day that the father now begins to take the boy. In the evenings, you find the father walking out. No, let's leave. Let your mother and the rest at home prepare the dinner. I want to walk with you. Can you accompany me? Let's walk through this road, no? The man begins to walk with his son during that time, telling him, you know, you are soon going to be a mature man now. You're not a child anymore, you know. And, you know, now you need to prepare a place for your bride, you know. You know, this land here, beginning from here, I've always wanted to give to you this. You see that? Beginning from here, I've always kept it for you. Because I thought that if you could build yours on this side, then you mind, since I'm here, and still we have enough room for the crop on this side. So this, I've always kept this for you. In my heart, this is the area I always wanted to give you, so you can build here. So you also, with your wife, may have a place. You see that? My son, I did not want to leave you in nobody's hands. That's why I took care of this. I knew that such a time would arrive. And the son would begin to build. The son has changed his behavior now. He's building, he's preparing. The father is giving him tips. You know, my son, you know, you always have to maintain. You know, the bedroom always belongs to the wife. You see that? Don't always quarrel. The kitchen belongs to your wife. Don't always be there. He's training him to mature, preparing him for the bride. You see that? The guests always belong to the wife. She's the one always to take care of the guests. Don't get involved in those little things. You just be with the guest, you know? In the Jewish culture. And I thought it was a joke when I was there. I did not know God was training me to talk to you people. Nobody knows the day or the hour of the wedding, even the year. The Jewish man keeps it as a secret. But the season of the wedding is known. Everybody in Israel knows the wedding season. When the new crop is being harvested and the new wine is being brewed. You see that? When the new wine is entering the wine jars, the old wine is out, the new crop has come, has entered the barns, now the wine is new. That is the season you begin to hear, weddings are taking place in the village. So the season is known by all. It is summer. It is harvest time. There is no rain. But the wine is stronger, is newer. Hallelujah. That is the anointing of God. The latter anointing, the power of the anointing of such a time as this. Hallelujah. The anointing is mighty at this time. Somebody, everybody can feel something has changed. The wine is too strong. People are operating under the influence of the new wine. People are just happy. There is so much joy going on, no? Brightness has come. You see? The winter has gone. But before the wedding, the Jewish man, the husband, always sends some people to the bride to investigate her. Lest we be related. You see that? We might bring a girl who is related to this boy. And that's abomination. You see that? Lest we find that this is actually a daughter to an aunt. Because this boy just went out there and found a girl. They go out there. Now he sends somebody to spy. A few people, maybe one or two. Find out the genealogy. Under which door does she come? Which clan? Which tribe? Is it from Ephraim? Benjamin? Is it from Gad? Get some details, you know. Number two, find out, is that a woman worthy of entering this home? You understand? They are very particular of who is added to their homes. That's why in Jewish settings, you find them always exclusive in their own, you know. In Nairobi, they maintain their synagogue there, you know. Just a small Jewish community. Among other things, you want to find out whether she's worth coming to this home. Find out, has she been faithful out there to my son who is waiting faithfully here? And then the spy will find out, is she with somebody? You see that? Then that day, you just cut it. If she has breached that contract of that wine they drank, it is cut. The man will say, ah, my son, I'll find for you another. You see that? And then finally, when time is almost The father now sends one messenger to visit the home. Now to come to the home, not to investigate out, to come to the home. Where are you from? Where has the journey removed you from? That's how they put it. Where has the journey gotten you from? Yes, I'm coming from far. From so-and-so's family. Isn't that close to the family where, you know? Yes, they are the ones who have sent me. They say now things are going to get ready. They feel like they are ready. You see that? They are ready now. So they feel they wanted you people to prepare, you know, because now they are ready for the wedding. Anytime it will happen now. You see that? He sends a messenger. That is Matthew 22. After my friends wedded, I need to finish this. After my friends wedded, the day of the wedding came, puff, they wedded. There are many things in the wedding we don't need to share here. I've published these things so it may help the church. In the wedding, the peak of the wedding ceremony is when they are dancing, 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 and they crush a glass. The man has to jump up holding the bride, jump up and crush, they put a glass and crush a glass with his feet. That is what you see in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 56. In fact, that is almost 56 itself, verse 56. When he says, now death has been crushed. Your sting has been taken away. You'll never touch my bride again. That is the symbolism that was happening. That's why I said our Lord came from the Jewish community. You like it or not? But usually, after wedding his bride, they disappear. And there's so much chaos there. Oh, who gave the PA system? They want a check for their money, cleaning up the homes, the drums, the water, the wine, everything. It's just confusion there. But he has escaped. They normally go to Anatolia, to Europe, where for their honeymoon. With his bride. After he comes back, I was so amazed because I had gone to town, you know. And that's the day he had come back. They had come back the night before from Anatolia. My friend there, they went to Anatolia, Turkey, for honeymoon. It was a Saturday. Because I was surprised, why is she still wearing the wedding gown? She was still wearing the wedding gown. He's holding her hand, walking with her in the street, brought her back to show the world his bride. Finally showing the world, he's parading his bride. Look, my bride. Look at how clean her gown. I was wondering, why is this woman still wearing the so white, so pure gown? That is what Isaiah saw. And close yourself for a little while. There is tempest here, confusion here. But then you will return with him. He is coming to show the world, look at my bride. Coming to Jerusalem. 7 years. So that gown you prepare is very critical. It is eternal. And that's why he said, you cannot wait for rapture. You just have to get ready, light your lamp now. Because it's 1 minute to midnight. I cannot be teaching these things in Germany. In other countries, we have TV programs, we air. We are sending them everywhere. And yet inside here, people are not aware. They are waiting for rapture. Why are you waiting? You have been told it will happen. You see that? You'd rather be ready today. And make sure on a daily basis you are ready. If there is somebody flashing you an SMS, a lady, and you think, you know, the Holy Spirit can help you to discern that this is not clean, you know? Those are the things you delete out. You prepare today and you repent. If there is a secretary in an office, not clean enough the way she's acting towards you. He says, take a knife and remove that eye. You see that? Take an axe and cut that arm. You see that? Do something radical for Christ. He did something radical for you on the cross. You see? You cannot sit there, okay, but the day of the rapture, see, I will do that. I'll prepare. What do you mean you'll prepare? I want to show you that that day he comes to close the door. That's why every day, every country says, on November 1st, the Lord, he opened the door and the glory came up. Which means, I looked back and I almost collapsed. I said, wow, Kumbe, he sent me across the nations to announce that the door is open. I was shocked recently when I discovered, when he talked to me about the door. I now understood. Now I could look back at all the tapes in every country, every place. I said, on November 1st, he opened heaven. That is what he sent Noah to do. Tell them it's open now. It is soon going to close. The rapture day is the day for closing. You cannot wait, I will prepare. You prepare now. Because he comes like a thief. Second coming, we know, after rapture, 7 years, you know? Listen to this. He says, verse 36, the book of Matthew 24, I'm finishing now. No one knows about the day or the hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son of Man, but only the Father. Verse 37, as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field, one will be taken, and the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill, one will be taken, and the other left. Therefore, keep watch. Did you hear that? Keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. That is the same watch he talks about in the Garden of Gethsemane. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he took the same three. He had 12 apostles. There was the whole population around there, but only 12 were drawn to him. You see that? That means that 12 was really a remnant. Do you hear me? Out of the whole population, only 12 were drawn to him, following him. But out of the 12, he pulled out only three. That is the purification Zechariah saw. That the remnant I will take, pass through fire, and now pull out my people. The three. Hallelujah. Peter, John, and James. When it was time to go to the mountain of transfiguration and reveal the Christ in him, the glory of Christ, he took the three. Do you hear me? My people now. I will say they are my people, and they will say the Lord is our God. The others even confused his name. When he was walking in water, some of them said, look, it is a ghost coming. They did not even identify Christ, right? They did not know whom they were walking with. I see that in the church today. I see multitudes of Christians walking without knowing the Christ they're walking with. Otherwise, they would have not fallen to sin. He took out Peter, James, and John to the mountain of transfiguration and revealed the Messiah. They saw a mighty visitation. Even the rapture cloud, even the open door to heaven, they saw. The door that I'm announcing here today. At the Garden of Gethsemane, he pulled out the same three, and then he warned them. He said, be watchful. Don't sleep. Be watchful. Don't ever sleep. Be watchful.
church full. Don't ever sleep, he told them. But the time was such that darkness had come. The dark hour had arrived. There is something called the circadian rhythm, the biological clock. God created man with a biological clock. That's why every time it reaches night, you begin to doze, become drowsy and sleepy. Hallelujah. The biological clock God put in your life tells you, at this time you must sleep. You see that? So you can replenish the cerebral spinal fluid, replenish the ATP synthesis, what build up, all that, you know. So tomorrow you're invigorated, ready to go. Every time, the way God created that clock, so it is in the spirit. Every time when you see people, like if we are continuing today, we can continue up to about 11 o'clock p.m. But when 11 p.m. arrives, when the darkness becomes thicker now, much thicker, everybody will now say, dozing. You see that? That's what God warned them against at Gethsemane. Be watchful. Don't sleep. Because you don't know when he comes. You see that? In Gethsemane he said, be watchful that you may not be tempted. But what was the temptation? Because his prayer in Gethsemane was that, Father, not my will, but your will. So that, because he said, the flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. That's the Holy Spirit that anointed him and took him to the cross. So, in other words, he was telling the remnant church, make sure you are watchful and in prayer. You see that? Because say watchful and pray, he said, that you don't fall into temptation, which means that the devil does not let your flesh overrule. Let the will of the Father overrule. You see what he said? Mm-hmm. And this is the hour for that to happen. Listen to this. Right now, the spiritual clock is 11:59 p.m. and the darkness is thicker. There is a tendency for the church to go become drowsy and sleep at this time. Like it is in the physical that God created, so it is in the spiritual of God. You see that? I know that your clock is telling you it is time to sleep. You are so tired, but he's saying, don't sleep at this time. Be watchful. The midnight hour is near, but the darkness is gross. Just yesterday, they opened a big door. Homosexuals from all over the world are going to wed in California. The flights are full with gay people heading to California. The door has been opened. The church is asleep, and the devil came and sowed the seed of weed, grass, inside the church. Homosexuality is in the church. She is numb to sin. She cannot feel, ooh, that was sin. She cannot feel that. It's just another news item. Wow, California, wow. She doesn't know that means calling on the wailing woman in America to begin wailing until all of them, their eyes are covered with wet, watery, full of tears. And this is the time for the American woman to come out and cover her head with ashes and face and wear the sackcloth. False prophets are in the church. Mungiki is planning to do a national prayer, a satanic prayer in the nation. Isn't this the time for the woman to come out? Isn't the darkness gross? And this is the time when the spiritual biological clock is most likely to make the church go to sleep. So this is the time to wake up if you are the remnant. If you watch in Gethsemane, the way he rebuked them 3 times, did you see that? Very bitterly, was so angrily rebuking them. You mean you could not just wait for me 1 more hour? You see that? He's asking the church the same thing right now. You have been Christian all this time with me. You mean now, this dying moment, this most crucial time, you could not wait for me just 1 more hour here now?
so I may come. Be watchful for me. Watch out for me. Watch for me. Hallelujah. And that's what he talks about here. But what's amazing here is at the time of Noah, there was the same darkness. You see that? But Noah went out to announce the rapture door that I'm talking about. He said, look, the door is open. Look, the door is open. Soon there is going to be a flood, a tribulation. You see that? Nobody accepted. They thought Noah was crazy. When I came to Kenya, what did they say about me? I am crazy. That's the first thing they labeled me with. Something is wrong with him. When I was prophesying the Asian tsunami, the first one, the big one, before it happened, they said, you're absolutely out of your mind. God promised never to kill anyone with floods. That's the first thing they told me. They told Noah he was crazy when he was pointing them towards the open door. He sent me to announce the door that is open. They have called me crazy. In Matthew 22, I don't want to go there right now. I first want to go to Genesis chapter 7, verse 16. On this door. I want to begin from Genesis 7. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Verse 16. Look at what he says here, somebody. The animals going in. Again, Genesis chapter 7, verse 16. The animals going in were male and female of everything as God had commanded Noah. Then the Lord shut him in. Do you see the door of the rapture? Yes. Then the Lord shut him in. Noah did not shut the door. God turned around and shut the door. He brought my people, some other people he created, he left out there. Same God created them. Do you understand me now? God turned around. And the Lord shut him in. Because if Noah had shut him in, Noah would have seen, oh, that is Zachary. Nani? Oh, we can share here. He gave us bread the other day when we had a guest. Oh, just allow only one. Please open for Zachary only. He did not allow men to shut the door. Men would have been sympathetic. You understand? Do you understand what Isaiah saw? Yes. And her slain she cannot conceal any longer. The blood that has dropped on her, the earth, will all now be disclosed. Her evil will come out. Because the sinful one will be judged. Tribulation. Is somebody walking with me? And you see here that God himself shuts the rapture door. God himself. I know every day you say, oh, me when I'm tired of things, I just go to Christ. I just be with him. Me, I just want to be with him. That day, he will shut the door on you. You will discover another nature of Christ you have not known. Hallelujah. If you read the book of Revelation I just read, it says, flames are coming from his eyes like swords. You see that? That means you are now seeing another countenance of the Lord. Another character of Christ. Hallelujah. Listen to this. That door is open right now. Ever since he sent me, it is open. Why wouldn't you enter? You have to enter now. If there is anything, any yeast that has been corrupting your walk with the Lord, this is the time to clean it out. You see that? I like saying this, if you allow me, can I? I like using Israel. Again, when I was in Israel, you know, when God went to save Israel in Egypt, he sent Moses, right? Yes. And he told Moses, at the midnight hour, I will come. But how would they prepare? They were supposed to get a lamp. If you read Exodus 12, we don't have time. I'm not teaching on that today. Exodus 12. Let me read it because we have guests here, so they may teach it in their countries. Exodus 12, you can read, for example, verse 5, verse 7. Look at this. Verse 5. Exodus 12. The animals you choose must be year-old male without defect. Underline without defect. They are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides of the doorposts and on the door frames in the houses in which they live. I want to live there. And then down there, of course, they say bread without yeast. Eat it roasted. Eat bitter herbs. Hallelujah. Now, when you go on down in Exodus 12, he says, do this as a lasting ordinance. Always keep remembering this. Teach your children, even when you enter Israel, when you are so modern, you are such a high-tech country with the best medical system in the world, the best lawyers in the world, the best economy in the world, the best scientists in the world, when you reach there. But don't forget this. He told them. But this one, don't forget. Teach it to your children and the children's children as a lasting ordinance, covenant between me and you. To remember the day I delivered you from slavery at the midnight hour. Hallelujah. So when you come to Israel, they call it Pesach, meaning Passover. You see that in Hebrew. When that Pesach is coming, what is most important is the first dinner is 7 days. The first dinner is called Seder, and the seventh dinner, the last dinner, when you're breaking out now. Everybody prepares for that dinner. You see that? Way in advance, months in advance. Because they know they don't want the midnight hour to get them wrong. You see that? In that house, in the Jewish home, anything that ever touched yeast, anything that ever touched bread with yeast, do you hear me? You buy from the bakery, it's buffalo. It's bread, it's a loaf with yeast. Eh? You might microwave it. You might cut it on the cutting board using a knife. You might bake it. The Jewish woman likes baking her bread, her own bread. So she uses yeast there, you know. Whether it's an oven she used. Anything that ever touched yeast is thrown out to the garbage. Nobody heard me here. Anything that ever touched yeast in that house, whether it's a new microwave, whether it's a nice clock on the wall in the kitchen, whether it's in the dining room, there is a TV, a flat screen, but there they used to put bread near it there. Whether it's an oven, whether it's a clock, a TV in the kitchen, whatever it is loaded on the pickup, thrown in the garbage dump. They really clean up their homes from yeast. Did somebody hear me? It stunned me. I was shocked at first. First time I was shocked. Because the garbage was full. Sofa sets, nearly everything, what they used, anything that touched yeast. No? It was so full that the highest business in Israel at such a time is the business of garbage collection. During that time, I knew that there would be no bread in the shops. You see that? So that's why I was upset. All foreigners used to be upset, you know. During this time, it was difficult to find bread. There is what we call matzah, which is bread without yeast. That is the only bread being sold everywhere in Israel. Everyone, and that bread has no taste. That is the bread God was telling Egypt to eat, Israel to eat in Egypt. He was telling them to prepare for the midnight hour. You have to eat that bread which is tasteless. After Joseph had died and slavery came now in Goshen, their slave masters were very bad. They built the pyramids. Their backs were being whipped. You see that? Very cruel. But they were going every day to that workplace because they had to earn bread, some bread for the family. Right?
They lived their years, their many lives and many years working for bread with yeast. When they reached home, they trembled. Everybody, now the family, the slave family, You have to break a bit, give to everybody, share, pass it around piece by piece. They have brought food home. The slave family, you see that? But when God said that now they would not eat bread with yeast, they trembled more. They panicked. They said, hey, but that one we're not used to. That one is not tasty. They are used to tasty. Right? God told them, get off the yeast. So in Israel, that's what they do. I was shocked. You find new TVs, new DVD players, new flat screen TVs, new computers, laptops, thrown out. I said, why would someone throw such a thing? It touched yeast. It ever touched yeast. You see that? However expensive it is, the same thing the Lord is telling the church. Now that the midnight hour is coming, however expensive it is, however much your life is tied to it, the way pastors get tied to some woman in the church, a woman who is really shelling good money, you understand that? He cannot even rebuke her dressing. She's always going around with pastor, you see that, Until people are just saying, just a moment, this is not right. You go to pastor's office, she's the one doing things there, Pastor's wife is where now? Where is the role of the pastor's wife? People have started to complain, you see that? She's the one driving pastor's car to go change oil. And people say, this thing here, this thing is not the right thing. You see that? But he cannot rebuke even her dressing. Because she is shelling. You see that? Pastor says, those are the few sheep I have. The no-no. They call it the fat sheep. The ones, when they touch the fat, you don't feel the bones. Touch the back of the sheep. They are the ones who are keeping me going. He says like that. And yet there is a lustful relationship going on there, which makes the wife uncomfortable. You see that? The Lord is saying, however sweet it has been, out to the garbage now. Let the midnight not find you with that yeast. Okay? Let the midnight hour not find you with that yeast. Oh, these are the main supporters of the church. Okay, if they are the supporters of the church, then let the Holy Spirit use you to purify them. So they can be holy, dress holy, walk holy, preach holy. Convert them, then deliver them for Christ. If they're the ones he brought to support you. But don't let sin and yeast get an excuse of creeping around this word. Do you hear me? And then pastor is now compromising his word. Pastor is now, you see, a man has changed completely. He's not the man you knew. Do you hear me? Now he's talking more of other things, buying land, property, his special offering for pastor, whatever. Those things now are happening. But that is the yeast. You that preach, that's the yeast. Okay? In Israel, it's like close your eye and throw. You understand? And they begin from scratch. And I used to ask, well, now how is this? Talk to me about this thing. He says, no, because we don't take chances, because anything could have touched yeast, especially in the kitchen area, just get rid of it. You see that? Even in the dining area. Even in the place you put bread, whatever it is. But we look at it positively, because it gives us a chance to build the house anew, he said. Did you hear that? He said, for so long I was looking at those sofas for many years, I was tired a bit. You hear that? The church also, for so long you have looked at the same countenance. The same features are in the church. Same conduct, same worship. You can almost come and predict what is going to happen after this worship. What the pastor is going to stand and say. What is going to, But the church needs now build anew.
This message is a chance for the Church of Christ in Rwanda to build a new house. This message is a chance for the Church of Christ in Tanzania to build a new house. This message is a chance for the Church of Christ in Uganda to build anew. It's a chance for the Church of Christ in DRC to build anew. It is a chance for the Church of Christ in Kenya to build it anew. Don't look at how expensive what you've thrown is. Just look at the good side of it. That is a chance for me to start anew. Amen. It is a chance for the four corners of the earth to start anew. A new walk, a spiritual journey. Not anymore a physical journey. Do you hear me, somebody? So there is a lot you can learn about the midnight hour from the Bible. God did not give you this Bible for fun. Everything from the first book of Genesis to the last book of Revelation is about the rapture. Like it was during the time of Noah, so will it be at the coming of the Son of Man. The time of Noah, the door was opened, the door was announced, but on that day it was shut. So will it be shut. The book of Matthew 25, the five wise virgins. I'm talking about the door to rapture, okay? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I did not know this what the Lord wanted to do. At your, we are preaching rapture. That we are preparing the church. How can you prepare if you yourself are not prepared? How can you deliver when you are not yet delivered? The book of Matthew chapter 25, precious people. As I finish this now, I bring the ship to the shore. Then I'll anchor it. Anchor it on the four glorious gospels, right? Yes. Hallelujah. Do you see the importance of what John the Baptist talked about? Anchor your gospel, anchor your messages, anchor your preaching, anchor your sermons unto the four glorious gospels. Those are the four white horses that the Father showed me when John the Baptist was talking to me. And then from that point on, you can now navigate the entire Bible to the four ends of the earth. Okay? Yes. So Matthew 25, this is what he says. He's talking about the parable of the 10 virgins, okay? And you see very carefully what the Lord said when the midnight hour is near, verse 5. He says, the bridegroom was long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. Matthew 25, verse 5. You saw that? That is where the church is. She's in a spiritual sleep. Because the spiritual clock says it's spiritually 11:59 p.m., right? But then the bridegroom comes. But look at what verse 10 says. Hallelujah. Verse 10 says, but while they were on their way to buy the oil, he's talking about the five foolish virgins, okay? The bridegroom arrived, and the virgins who were ready went in with him to the banquet, the wedding banquet. Listen to what he says there. And the door was shut. The door was shut. Not one of the virgins went back and shut the door. Was shut by God. Did you see the same thing happening at the time of Noah? But what amazes me here, you have the remnant church that comes out. 10 wise virgins step out of the church, out of the walls of church. They go to evangelize Christ, right? In the streets, in the markets, everywhere. That's the remnant church that steps out. Let's say church, you can also be, you can be in the world, but you have stepped out from the world, right? You can be in the four corners, but you have four walls, but you have stepped out of the world. That's the separation that the virgins did, right? It's a spiritual separation, right? But five of the virgins were burning some strange lamps, right? All the lamps go on, the 10 lamps, wise and foolish, five wise, five foolish, go on up to right close to the midnight. But when the midnight cry is announced by that one that went to talk to that family, that family is now ready to come and wed your daughter. You see that? That was the time to trim the wicks, right? He says, and they woke up, you see? The cry rang out. Then all the virgins woke up, verse 7, and trimmed their lamps. That's the time to trim the kitambi, the wicks. Why is it important to trim the wicks? Because the midnight hour is nigh, it is near. The light that your candle has been emitting throughout this night has been sufficient, right? You say, your word is like a lamp unto my feet, right? Has been sufficient, right? But when it comes the midnight hour, the darkness became thicker. And you enter that house and say, hey, is there no lamp here today? Is there no light in this house? They say, no, there's a lamp. It's at the corner there. So how come today I feel as if it's just dark here? The darkness at the midnight hour becomes thicker. And that's why there is need to trim the lamp, add the oil, and glow the flame, because you need now a stronger flame from the lamp. You see that? Otherwise, the thick darkness is aimed by the devil. It is intended by the devil to undermine the lamp that you've been lighting. To undermine it so it appears as if there is no lamp. Does somebody see the church there? Her lamp cannot be seen. Nobody has stood out. The lamp is dim. The lamp you are used to cannot work anymore. That's why there is need to start anew. The Jewish people throw the sofa sets out. Start anew. It's a spiritual start anew. You see that? You need to trim the lamps, pour the oil that the light may be stronger, commensurate, proportionate, correspondingly to the level of darkness in this dispensation. You see that? This is what the Lord is saying here. But what amazes me is that the same deception the Lord talked about in Matthew 24 shows up here. When he says, the five foolish ones were told to go buy oil. You see that? While the wise ones poured the Holy Spirit into their salvation, and they lit their lamps into the wedding, into eternity. Their gown was glorified by the latter anointing, right? The dew that Isaiah saw, that's the jar, okay? The jar of oil they carried, that's the dew. They poured, transformed them into immortal spiritual bodies, and they entered into the wedding of the Lamb, right? That's the dew that I want to talk about. But what's amazing to me, that the foolish virgins were told to go buy some oil, and they surely went. That tells you that they were burning a different oil, right? They could even go to the same shops and look for it. Who can buy the anointing of the Holy Spirit? But today you see the church is selling it on TV, right? They're selling small bottles of anointing, eh? Or a small handkerchief. I'm told if you buy it, cover yourself, anointing will cover you. They're selling the Holy Spirit. If you send me a gift, a love gift of what, I've prepared so many bottles, small bottles of anointing oil to give you. People can go there, buy. Depending on your money, you can buy the size of the bottle. They went to buy. And that raises the question of the fact that when the 10 lamps were lighting, surely there must have been confusion to the sheep, right? To know which is really the genuine lamp and which is coming from the Holy Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit and which is coming from the enemy. You see that? The false tongues were here as the Holy Spirit was giving true tongues. The false prophecies were here as the Holy Spirit was speaking true prophecy on the rapture, the repentance, the holiness of God. There was mchanganyiko malum, there was a mix in the church. Deception that the Lord talked about in Matthew 24, right? Be careful. At that time, many will come to deceive you. Make sure you're not deceived. Falsehood. The biggest sin of the Antichrist is what? Deception. He will come to lie to them that he is he that comes from the Lord, that they may worship him like they have worshipped Christ. You see that? That is preparing the way during the beginning of birth pains into the biggest dispensation of deception, which is tribulation. Right? And that's what you see God is talking about here. But what's amazing to me is that the door, you need the Holy Spirit, the anointing of the Holy Spirit to enter through this door. You see that? And the door is shut. That is the rapture door I'm talking about today. Make sure when it is shut, you are on the other side, the inside of heaven side. Hallelujah. And in the same Matthew 25, verse 41, right? He says, then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cast into eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. And I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. You closed the door. The door was shut. To tell you the truth, I don't know you. You understand? So the Lord is telling the church that this is the moment to enter. You can spiritually enter, which means prepare. Like the time of Noah. All Noah ever wanted them to do is to repent and prepare, be ready. Because it might happen any time. And when the floods came, Noah entered the ark, right? And all of them were, oh, please help us. No, please. This is what? Don't you remember me? Remember me, please. I'm the one. That, do you remember your neighbor? They will say anything at that door when the tribulation comes. You see that? But the door will be shut. And the Lord will totally not open the door. He will completely refuse to open the door. Because the window, the door has been open long enough. You understand? It has been open. But he will not accept that they enter. Because it has been open. All he ever wanted them to do is repent and be ready. Because you don't know the time. You don't know when he comes in. It's very important for the church not to wait for the rapture, but to get ready today. You see that? Because the rapture happens in a twinkling of an eye, which means it's essentially the closing of the door. You see that? It's very critical that you get these people, precious people. Don't miss out on the rapture. Don't wait for the rapture. Just prepare now. So when it happens, anytime, you are ready. You see that? Especially that you are carrying this message. You've chosen, you want to carry this message. You want the church to be purified. You want the church to see the kingdom of God. But the question is, how about you? However expensive it is, however precious it is, however addicted you are to it, for as long as it constitutes yeast, out to the garbage at this moment, you still have a moment to start anew. You will not have that moment again. You see that? And time has run out. And that's what the Lord is saying concerning the rapture door. That the church may prepare. All of you, regardless of nation, we are all the same in his eyes. That all may enter through this door before he shuts the door. It is a very sad thing for the door to shut on you. You see that? Make sure it does not shut on you. And remember, the floods went on for some time and Noah and his team were in the safety of the ark. After a while, the boat came to Mount Ararat and then it anchored there. You see that? And then they came out, the dove came out, and then talk about the dispensation of the Holy Spirit. You see that? And then Noah picked some clean animals. And the covenant was arrayed by God after the sweet fragrance reached him. You see that? That talks about the dispensation of the Holy Spirit when Jesus will come in the second coming. During all this time, the door of Noah is the door that Isaiah saw. That is the door God showed me in that heaven. That opened and is open until today. That is the door that opened at the mountain of transfiguration. You see that? And then raptured the two. You see that? That door is open today. And Isaiah said, for a little while, enter into your rooms and shut the door behind you for a little while until his wrath has passed by. When Jesus comes, the enemy is bound for 1,000 years. You see that? the dispensation of the Holy Spirit, the reign of the Dios, the kingdom of God will reign. He will rule with an iron scepter. He will rule with an iron thing. When he says homosexuality is sin, it will be sin. Period. Nobody will go to court. When he says lying is sin, it will be sin. Period. Nobody will argue. For 1,000 years of peace, which means there will be a good fragrance, a powerful fragrance that Ezekiel saw. He said only the prince can now stand at the door when that eastern gate will open. And then he will eat at that door. And then he will offer sacrifices unto our God in the temple. So that a little while that Isaiah talked about is the 7 years. The 7 years of tribulation. 3.5 for tribulation, 3.5 of great tribulation. For a little while, and then the door opens again. When the boat anchored at Mount Ararat, the door opened again. You see that? When the tribulation passed, the door opened. Christ is coming to Jerusalem. The door opens again. May the Lord bless you that you may enter through that door.
Amen.
Before it shuts.
Amen.
Shalom. And for those of you who are watching by TV, I want you to know that it does not matter whatever you are doing, wherever you do it from, whether you've been a pastor, it will not matter anymore. Many have said they are pastors. Many have thought being a Christian for many years give them a qualification to enter through this door. I have celebrated this mighty door to the wedding of the Lamb of God today, and I've said, don't wait for the rapture. Just prepare for the rapture, even as the word has said. The word tells us nobody knows the day, even the hour, let alone the year. The only thing that the word says is that we should be watchful at all times, so we may be able to enter through this door. I have celebrated this mighty door, the door that leads into the kingdom of God. You don't want that door to shut on you. Whether you pass at a church and you know that you've not walked right, it is still open for you. That door is the door that John the Baptist came to announce. He said, behold, he is coming. He said they should repent and enter because the kingdom of God is at hand. I am announcing it to you today. It does not matter your nationality. It does not matter how long you've been born again. It does not even matter from which color, which tribe, which race, which gender. All that matters is that you may be able to repent today and get the yeast out of your life, return to holiness, and enter through this door. Because on the day of the rapture, it surely will be shut. Not by man, by the Lord God Almighty himself. And if you feel like you want to receive the Lord today, start anew, repeat with me. Repeat this prayer. Say, precious Lord Jesus, I have lived as a sinner, and I repent today. I repent of all sin since I was born until the day of rapture. I am repenting today. Clean me, Jesus. And write my name in the book.
The book of life.
Lord Jesus, restrain me.
Don't allow me
to go back to sin.
And fill me today
with the anointing of the Lord.
The morning dew.
That I may enter
into the wedding of the Lamb.
Of the In the name of Jesus.
In the
mighty name of Jesus.
I begin anew today.
Amen.
Amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, before you are precious people. And Lord, they have dedicated their lives today to beginning anew. Lord, you are faithful to your word. You have led me to speak to them, Jehovah. You know their condition. You know their situation. But you are more than able to restrain them from relapse, to restrain them from recycle, that they may not go back to sin. Lord, today I release your mighty anointing into their lives, that the Holy Spirit may allow them to enter through this door. The door you have celebrated so much, the door you have announced so much, the door you have cherished so much in the kingdom of God. In the name of Jesus. Amen. May the Lord bless you.